evening. Welcome to another edition of the South Atlantic Media Services Local TV News broadcast. Making the headlines in this week's news: Atlantic Star announce new flights to the UK, short visit of tall ship bark EUROPA, 20 years of growing St Helena coffee, end of cricket season report, and St Helena celebrates National Day. On Thursday, the 21st of May, Atlantic Star Airlines announced they will be introducing a new flight from the UK to St Helena. The first flights will take place shortly after the airport opens. A plane will fly from the UK to St Helena, stopping to refuel in West Africa, and will return by the same route. The plane will do the same journey 2 weeks later, which will allow tourists a two-week stay on St Helena, and Saints on Island can spend a fortnight abroad before flying back home. The company have only planned for one trip to the island, but hope to provide further flights during peak seasons, such as the holiday periods. However, Atlantic Star's director, Captain Andrew Radford, told SAMS that for now they are focused on making a success of the first pair of flights. There is no government funding available for these new flights. However, Atlantic Star still thinks the prices for the tickets will be very competitive compared to the RMS. The flight will take 12 hours, landing at a London airport. The plane is a Boeing 757-200, which can carry approximately 180 passengers and some cargo. Atlantic Star's commercial director, Aidan Walsh, said they expect a high demand for these services and they will be encouraging early bookers by offering them the best prices on each flight. Founder Richard Brown added that they look forward to sharing more details on the flights in the coming weeks. Tall ship Bark EUROPA sailed into James Bay on Tuesday, the 12th of May. The vessel has been to St Helena several times and was happy to let SAMS aboard for a tour. On the EUROPA, everyone is considered crew, whether they are permanent or paying voyage crew. The ship's chief officer, Ruud Blaksale, spoke about the EUROPA and the experience of sailing.
It's a sail training vessel. She looks like she's from the Pirates of the Caribbean. But inside is pretty good. She's been transformed in 1995 from a light vessel to a sail training vessel. So she has not been a sailing ship all her life. She used to be anchored off a piece of horrible coast of Germany at the River Elbe. So she's built really solidly to withstand all the weather. But the hulk, so the hull, was empty when they bought her. So she's been fitted out quite conveniently, so she has bathroom and toilets in every cabin. Cabin is between 2, 4 or 6 people per cabin. There's electricity, 220. We have hot and cold water. You can take a shower basically. There's 3 meals a day, and the meals are, well, not what you expect probably of a sailing ship. So it's not only water, bread, and the fish you catch. It's also deep freeze stuff which we can prepare freshly. So yeah, it's semi holiday, semi work. It's a combination. It's an adventure.
All right.
Ship is 57 meters overall. It has 3 masts. Two of them are square rigged, so that means we have yards on them. They're horizontal pieces of wood which we can set to the wind. And one of it is a fore aft rig one, that's the mizzen mast, that's the third mast. That's why it's called a bark EUROPA. So the name of the ship is EUROPA, bark is the type of sailing ship there is. What else to tell? She has a maximum capacity of 65 people. All of the people are considered crew, so we have a sail training vessel, which means that everybody on the ship works to run the ship. Yeah, so we have 15 permanent crew members and up to 50 people who come and join us for a trip from, well, for example, St Helena to Ascension, and they learn to run the ship. Because it's a sail training vessel, we don't stay in a place very long. So we stay in Saint Helena 2 days and then we sail on. So we are just sort of, we go to a festival, an event, we do something on the ship and then we sail on. So it's a really a sailing ship. It's not a museum or a party ship. It's really, yeah, it's about living on the ship. It's about following your dreams, I think. You just, it's you have to envision yourself doing this. And if you have that sort of vision that you can do it, then just certainly do. And then this ship is the perfect ship to do it. So yeah, you set your sails, you pick up a trade wind, and you enjoy life. And it's a beautiful experience.
The vessel departed James Bay on Thursday, the 14th of May, headed for Ascension. She is now on her Cross the Equator voyage, which will see the crew travel 2,900 nautical miles to Horta the Azores. After 2 decades of making coffee on St. Helena, Jill and Bill Bolton and Brian Beard hosted an event this week celebrating one of the island's most famous products. Jill and Bill are planning to expand their coffee tours and offer both tourists and locals a chance to look around the plantation and finish the day with a cup of coffee and some cake. Bill, Jill and Brian, the last remaining 100 tree men who were given plants to kickstart coffee growing on St. Helena, provide the coffee for drinkers on island, both in packets and at the coffee shop in Jamestown. On the day, they showed their guests around the plantations at Rosemary Plain and talked them through the coffee growing process. A small seedling is planted and over time it grows into a full-size tree which has to be pruned regularly. Flowering starts at the end of February and the cherries developed from green to yellow to red. Only the red cherries are picked between October and February every year. The cherries are then pulped and dried, creating a beige bean, which is then put through a hulling process to remove the skins. The beans are then separated into different sizes and roasted for approximately 20 minutes, creating a dark brown, almost black bean, ready for use in the coffee grinder. Brian Beard said he had been approached to sell his coffee to companies from off the island. However, he chose to keep the coffee on St. Helena, only giving the company enough for the roast.
Thank you guys for coming and having a look. And if anybody's got any questions or want some coffee, go for it. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you.
Unfortunately, due to the bad weather, the plantation visitors were forced to stay undercover, sampling coffee as well as the St. Helena Distillery's Midnight Mist and new coffee chocolates made by Sarah Jane Sharman. The St. Helena cricket season drew to a close on Saturday, the 16th of May. Here now, with the report, is our sports guy, Damien Obey.
For the first time in cricketing history, a Levelwood derby was the main event for the season finale. All Stars had already been crowned league champions and were on a good run of form since losing the T20 final to St. Matthew's Lions 3 weeks earlier. Rebels had shown promise all season and their exciting brand of cricket in the latter part of the season earned them their spot in this year's knockout final. However, on the day, All Stars earned bragging rights over their local counterparts and picked up the knockout cup following an efficient performance in the final. All Stars combined to set Rebels a target of 210 thanks to knocks of 62 and 45 from Darrell and Siobhan Leo, with Ross Henry adding 43. In reply, Rebels collapsed to 131. The awards presentation followed the final. Jamestown Barracudas were runners-up in the league following a three-way playoff at the end of the season. Levelwood All-Stars were league champions and runners-up in the new T20 tournament sponsored by the RMS. St. Matthew's Lions were crowned T20 champions following Scott Crowe's amazing innings in the final. Levelwood Rebels were runners-up in the knockout, and Levelwood All-Stars picked up their third title of the season, 2015 knockout champions. Jason George's bowling average of 9.89 was the best returned all season, and Gavin George's batting average of 115 saw him win the governor's bat. Donnie Kleihan struck the highest number of sixes, and Alistair Buckley poached 12 catches, the most taken by anybody during the season. Russ Henry's 148 was the highest score recorded during the league. Danny Kleinhans picked up the Georgian Cup for the highest score in the first round of the knockout. Daryl Leo was voted wicketkeeper of the season. Aidan Leo was young player of the season. Danny Kleinhans picked up the Georgian Cup for the highest score in the first round of the knockout. Daryl Leo was voted wicketkeeper of the season. Aidan Leo was young player of the season. And Danny Kleinhans, Chris Dawson and Dax Richards were the players of the year after all three collected 17 performance points.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it and I've enjoyed every single game. Every ball I bowl, every ball I hit, every single run I ran, I've enjoyed it a lot. I would definitely come back and play more cricket here.
And that's the sports news for this week. Back to you, Nicole.
Thank you, Damien. On Thursday this week, the island celebrated St. Helena Day. Here now are some of the highlights that took place.
Just watch. Hey, hey.
brings us to the end of this week's edition of the South Atlantic Media Services Local TV News broadcast. I am Nicole Peters. Thank you all for watching.